Hello everybody, this is Alex here. I'm going to talk about a model today that I'm making by AIRFIX, the Harrier FRS1. I bought this in a sale not long back. It's got everything in it, all the paints, brushes, acrylic paint, cement as well, and you can use other cement as well. You don't have to use the one that's actually provided. 1/24 scale, which makes it at about 604mm long and about 320-something mm wide at the wings. It's a very good model, it's very well made. I do have some reservations about two things. The actual end of the wings in the model, they are a little bit flimsy. Could have been made a little bit stronger. And also the motor, or the engine should I say, sorry, the Pegasus engine, that's actually inside, and once you put the wings on top you can't see it, so there should be really another way of actually taking the wings off for people to have a look at the actual the engine. And the only other thing is the model we've got here is a normal land based version. You've also got a cockpit version in there of the Harrier with the refueling coupling on its cockpit. Now, word of warning here, if you intend using that version and you intend cutting it off behind the grills here or behind the cowlings here, you'll have a hell of a job trying to fit it, and there'll be a lot of bodywork and filling involved in actually getting it together. You can try it, but this is the version I've got here, the C version that would be used without the refueling pod. But otherwise, it's a great model. It's got lots of detail, lots of decals, an assortment, an array of weapons that you can actually fit, and makes it look very, very realistic. Now, what my aim to do was, with this actual AIRFIX model, which is very unusual, I know, there's a couple of companies that actually do a polystyrene version of the Harrier, and I think Hobby King actually do one that could be modified, and an Italian chap has actually made a flying model, a full-size flying model. Sorry, not a full-size flying model, but quite a big model, where he's using a round thruster that's fitted underneath here in this space, right, which is quite large, and not actually using the actual thrusters that the real plane are fitted with, or that you get on the model. Now, the instructions that you get are quite good, but unfortunately, like a long time ago, you get the items and they're all numbered off, but it doesn't tell you how to put it together. It gives you the things like this, or the codes to show you whether to glue it or keep it separate or whatever. And that's irrelevant. You just got to take your time when you're putting it together. There's nearly 400 pieces to this model. Now, looking at the Pegasus engine here, what's my intention to do is not fit these parts here at all. I could use them for something, but I'm not going to use them whatsoever, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the model, or I'm going to use the engine itself, and then I'm actually going to fit plastic pipe vectors on each side, and what I hope to be able to do is actually with the use of a 50 or a 40 millimeter EDF actually force thrust through the actual engine and out of the vectors at the sides. Now, what I actually did was, and this is only for display purposes at the moment, we've got the model here of the Pegasus engine, and what I actually did was I went out to my local hardware shop and I got some plastic piping. This one's 3/4 inch, this one's 1/2 inch, right, and cut them to a length that I know that once it's in the aircraft model, the fuselage, I can extend it or close or push it in or shorten it. For instance, look, I can shorten it or push it or pull it out to whatever length I need. for the reason that I'll show you later on. Now, when you're doing this and you're trying to get the things in, there's a little bit of force involved, unfortunately. It will glue back together. You can see when you look down the thing, if I push that out back again, you've got a full chamber like you would have in a normal real life aircraft. So all the thrust should go down there. And the only problem is, when I was doing it, slightly unavoidable, we got some damage to the outside of the vectors. Now, that's not a problem, because once the actual nozzles are in place, once the actual vectors are in place, you can use filler on that, fill it in and then sand it down, and that's the underneath part, and that's the underneath part anyway, so it wouldn't show even if you didn't do it. But to make it tidy, and that's the underneath part, to make it tidy and make it look presentable. Right, now on the end of these would fit the normal vectors that you would get on the real life aircraft. These will be used. This one's sellotaped at the moment, again, just for use, just for show. There we go, like that. So there will be one each side, and then one each side on that side. And then what I'll have to do is, when I've decided which type of motor I want, which type of EDF I want, I'm going to have to, unfortunately, cut a bit of this off, probably from about there to about there and there, because I don't want to attempt to cut anything off the motor, off the EDF fan, either at the front or the back. And then I'm going to have to use some kind of a plastic cowling to join this bit to the actual EDF, because I'll need to make sure that that is exactly in line with the actual fuselage on the model. And there's no way I'll be able to push it forward in the actual model because of the cockpit bulkhead on the actual model. There's no way to cut it down and fit the EDF in it. I'll show you what I mean in a minute when I go on to the fuselage. So that's my intention there. And then also from here, there'll be one pipe coming from the back here, right, which will go to the rear of the fuselage, just like on the real plane, and then one from each side here at the front, right, going to each wingtip, which what I'm hoping to use is two straws that have got the old, you know, the bendy ends, and take them to the wingtips, so it gives a bit of stability as well, just like in the rear aircraft. Right, let's just move them away now, out of the way for now. On the actual aircraft, and this again I've just stuck down with sellotape at the moment, you can see that's where the bulkhead goes. You can only get the EDF, you can only get the EDF as far as where that bulkhead is. Alright. It's a shame, actually, the plane was a little bit bigger. You could probably get two EDFs, one at each side. I don't think they do a 20mm EDF, and I don't think there'd be any purpose in doing it anyway. Right, so, as I say, it's about 620-odd mm long. Quite a lot of space inside. And this is where the cowlings are, where the thrusters would come out. And underneath you've got the thing for the opening for the bottom thruster, and also for the wheels. There's the wheels at the front there, It's got great detail, I've got to admit. I mean, look, you can go right down to the rivets on the actual panels of the aircraft. Now what I'm going to do, as I said, the motor will actually go in. I'll just move that to one side a minute. The motor will actually go in. And it will be in situ like that. inside the aircraft. So I've only got that space there to the bulkhead to fit the EDF. So it's definitely going to necessitate to have a little portion of this cut off. I mean, if you had this on a stand, I wouldn't have glued the wings on anyway. I'd have probably screwed them on, and using this panel here along the side, it's about 1/4 inch thick on each side. You get three nice little screws in there, and you can actually screw the wings on and then use some kind of a little like plastic pop thing to go on top of the screws so you can actually see them. Otherwise, you know, you built an engine and there's lots of stuff to go on top of here yet, and all the colouring and everything and the piping, you wouldn't see any of that with it fixed in. So I think it's a bit of waste. AIRFIX could have spent a bit more time in maybe not producing the engine, the Pegasus engine, and maybe spending a bit more money on the cost of the wingtips on the aircraft, and maybe making a better way of fixing the alternative cockpit to the aircraft. I mean, for those who are skilled modellers, they probably could do it, you know, they could probably take the cockpit off and fit the cockpit, but I'm not even going to attempt it. Right, so that's my plan, and as I say, ultimately I'm after trying to make it hover. Flying would be a bonus, and it isn't going to fly very high anyway, and it isn't going to probably not hover very high, but I shall give it a go. And I've been studying it a long time now, this last 2 months, as regards to bits and pieces and what I need, and hopefully it'll all come out nice. The cowling at the front, what you would normally see, the actual fan on the real aircraft, that would still be seen on the model. So what I might do is, I mean, you can't see it here in the picture, unfortunately, but what I might do on the actual model is fit a bar across there, just there. Let's move that up there a bit so you can see. Fit a bar across there, a plastic bar, straight across in front of the EDF, and then fix the actual fan from the model that you get onto it via with a little screw, and hopefully that would cause it to rotate while it was flying in, cause it to rotate while it was flying along. Might give it a bit more realism. Now, there is plenty of space in the model to fit your bits and pieces. I don't think I can get any servos fitted for the wing flaps, so there's not going to be a lot I can do about that. It's just too thin. I will have room to put the servos here, one on this side, one on this side, with the main servo down here at the back somewhere. And what I thought I would do also, depending on weight, is once I've sorted it all out, if I can get an MP3 player, strip it to bits and just use the electrical components, there's only two batteries normally on them anyway, I'd fit that in that with a mini speaker. The mini speaker could be fitted in the cockpit or under the wings or in the back somewhere. And I'd record some sounds of a Harrier, and put them on the MP3 player, give it that a bit of effect when it's actually hovering and moving left to right. That's about it really. One of the important things is, of course, the point of balance, which should be, from my reading up and watching videos, the forward edge of the wing, because not only are we going to have the weight of the EDF in there, we're going to have the weight of the batteries, the ESC controller, right, and anything else that's needed for the aircraft to fly. I've still got my rods to fit, servos. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. And if I don't do it and it doesn't work out, well, I'll just do it normally and put the aircraft together and put it on a stand. I won't be using a lot of the paints to paint on specific areas, because what I intend to do is actually use a spray mat or silk paint to give it that actual spotless finish that you get with a thing. I think if you paint it with a paintbrush, you tend to get it too thick and comes out too patchy. So we'll see, we'll give it a test try with a undercoat first, and then we'll spray the actual aircraft, and it'll have to be done bit by bit, to be quite honest, because there's just so much to do. Anyway, as I say, it's a wonderful kit. Look forward to actually doing it. There is a pilot somewhere in the box. I haven't opened the plastic bag really to go through everything, simply because it's going to be a couple of months really before I can get to actually start doing it proper. The engine's the main thing. If I know this isn't going to work, then there's no point in continuing and adding bits to it and trying to make it fly. Well, that's it for now. Wish me luck, and if there's anyone out there who's done any modelling like this on this scale, if you could send me any tips and put it in the comments box below, I'd be much appreciated. Thank you everybody for watching.